welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Mason Dambrot, your host. Today we're very fortunate. We have Alex Gabbay, a filmmaker and director. I was fortunate enough to see a screening of his newest film, Just Trial and Error, focused on the question, what do art and science have to say about consciousness? Equally serendipitous was the fact that I caught up with him after the showing, and with no time, because he's leaving to go back to the UK in a few days, we were able to get him to come in. So we're honored and very pleased. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
The thing I really am interested in is, how does one tackle, despite your incredible history of 50 documentaries filmed all over the world, 15 awards, including one recently for this piece that we're discussing, how does one approach and tackle such a complex and profound yet elusive subject as consciousness?
No, it's a very good question. How does one? I'm not sure I have the answer. In that, the way it happened was I began by bumping into someone who was curating a show for UCL, University College of London, on consciousness and the brain. They had brought together artists and neuroscience with the hope that, you know, they would come to some sort of discussion between them about, you know, some common area. Out of that, I chose certain people to be in the film, and those people who were interested in communicating were the ones that ended up on the film. The advantage being that, why I'm telling you this, is the advantage is that it's not actually me who is tackling the problem. I think these people really want to kind of explain it from their point of view. And what was interesting is that these people actually hadn't met after the filming, and they did meet, and they had a lot in common. So the structure of the film is to sort of, a bit like the name of the film, is to see what happens when you put artists and scientists together and tackle together the subject of consciousness. So I think in a way it's conversations on consciousness. It's people trying to make sense of consciousness from their different disciplines.
So that it was weaving a tapestry,
yes,
in a sense, an interdisciplinary tapestry with this subject in common.
Yeah.
And I noticed that the people who were in the film were getting to know each other in a sense as well,
yeah,
as evidenced by near the end of the film, Dr. Lotto's humorous comment about Gromley.
Yeah.
I won't repeat what he said, but it was very funny.
I think that because the filming went backwards and forwards over a period of time, they did become aware of who the other protagonists were, in you know, there's four of them, and they all respect each other, you know, in their own way, for their own work.
Another question I have then regarding all of this is, in the making of the film, you had certain, I'm sure, ideas and thoughts about the nature of consciousness when you started this. It got you know, otherwise you might not have been interested in the first place.
Sure.
Through the making of the film and then viewing it when it was a finished product, if you will, when the film was finished, and it's beautifully woven. It really is remarkably elegant, in my view. Mm-hmm. So what did you learn from that process, from the individuals, and from making the effort of trying to weave this tapestry with such mm-hmm. different, in some cases and sometimes, points of view concerning consciousness?
I think what came out of it is a sort of commonality. And not just art and science. Funny enough, even Buddhism, I mean, has a commonality with the other two, in the sense that what consciousness is about, from all the perspectives, is making sense. How you make sense of the world. So this is not. I mean, I had understood this from Buddhism before I started, but it's interesting to see that. Making sense of the world, the uncertainty of the world around you, and how you make sense of it is something that art does, is something that neuroscience is trying to do, and it's something that Buddhism has always talked about.
That's extremely interesting because the parallel in the actual physicality of life, it does the same thing. We tend to think when I'm looking at you that I'm seeing you. And in times past, it was actually assumed that there was a little picture of Alex in my brain, which we know not to be the case. It's patterns of neural net activation and reactivation and molecules that are formed through RNA and expressed as memory and all that stuff, all of that. But that being said, we are then actually not making sense in the sense of you're not making any sense. Why don't you communicate more clearly? But more making sense of constructing sense out of perceptual information that in and of itself does not necessarily connote the sense that we construct.
Yeah, totally. I mean, Bo Lotta, which is one of the scientists who is the perceptual scientist in the film, starts by, I mean, this I thought was fascinating. He starts by saying the light that falls on your eye has absolutely no sense in it. It doesn't mean anything. It's a pattern of light. But you know, the brain, your experience of what how to interpret this pattern makes it into what it is. So in a way, it's your past history, your narrative history that creates meaning. So you differentiate between this or that, whether it's a man or a woman, whether someone's got a smile, does that smile mean this and that? That pattern of light, you know, is then added with meaning, and that meaning can only come from the past.
Oh,
so that is his way of explaining.
That's very making that's actually sense. Very poetic. That's very poetic, and it also, to me, implies a different perspective on how we actually know anything, because that means that knowledge is not necessarily embedded in whatever we are engaged in, from which we derive knowledge. We actually bring something else to that party, also.
Correct, and I think that in that sense, what Bo Lotta talks about. And funny enough, so does Anthony Gormley, the artist, is this playing with uncertainty, being comfortable with uncertainty, and actually using uncertainty. For Bo, and he's particularly interested in educating children to see the fact that they are not necessarily that they're bringing meaning from the past to understand the present. And once you recognize the fact that you're influenced by your past, then you can actually kind of say, okay, I know that, but let me look at what I'm seeing and then judge it on the basis of what it is now, if possible.
So that's, it's almost, I wouldn't say mystical, but it is a very philosophical perspective that, in my view, Dr. Lotta brought to the things he was saying, because it really is talking about a type of introspection, in a way.
Yeah.
He was talking about seeing that, and I can't paraphrase, I have to paraphrase, but seeing what you're seeing as you're seeing it, understanding that you are the seer, more or less.
Yeah.
And that's a profound comment on consciousness, because if consciousness can be construed as, in fact, the homunculus that used to be thought to be a real entity is observing what we're observing while we're observing it and informing us about that observation. So that process of abstraction seems fundamental to the visual pathway, to the sensory pathways, as well as the creation or the emergence of a permanent sense of self that somehow can be aligned, if not equated completely with consciousness to some degree. And Dr. Lotta was extremely articulate.
He was very good, yeah. And I think for him it's important to be comfortable in this. And one of the experiments he tries to do is to create to translate what you see into sound so that you can actually hear what you see.
Kind of the inverse of what the performance artist did after the film, which was translate sound into visual.
But in a way, it's the same difference. It's just using one sense to kind of be able to observe the other sense.
That's very interesting.
So that way you realize that in a way, you are able to. Again, it's this idea that you bring from a sort of post hoc narrative of what you see, but when you translate it into another sense, it may be something new. So you're looking at it with new eyes.
So in relation to what we were talking about before, you're kind of mapping the meaning creating the meaning and mapping it from one sense modality to another.
Yeah.
So with that very interesting introduction, why don't we take a look at the trailer?
Afraid?
Afraid of whom? Of you? No, not anymore.
What of it?
There is the hard question. How does matter, which has no consciousness, give rise to consciousness?
Neuroscience is a form of mapping, it seems to me. I think the definition of consciousness is the one thing that neuroscience has sidestepped. We're dealing with the how, not the why.
We've been trying to divine for it with inappropriate tools. So it's like when we want to calibrate our musical instruments, we use a tuning fork. We don't go and use a ruler.
Why we see what we do. Understanding that's tremendously important. Creating a situation where people can actually observe themselves making sense of the world. In many respects, this is consciousness. This ability to be an outside observer of yourself.
One of the things that we know about brains is that they're plastic. They change with experience.
I'm not particularly interested in understanding humans as such, given that I work on perception, which is something that is relevant to any visual animal. I sort of think of bees as like little flying people.
It's a wonderful thing to be misunderstood. I mean, space is the subject of the work.
It's not particularly well structured. It's quite chaotic, but it is a collective effort of preserving global consciousness and ensuring that it's moving with a good velocity.
We probably experience about 1,000 numbers an hour, or 16,000 numbers a day, or 6 million numbers in a lifetime.
Only about 10% of the information that the brain uses to see comes from the eyes. The same thing, is, of course, is true in bumblebees and, in fact, all nervous systems.
I think that sculpture is, in the age of the internet, so utterly important because it brings us back to that tactile, enduring, resistant presence of thingness.
We do have to find more imagination within ourselves, more creativity, more collectivism.
How is it possible to be an effective citizen in a numerate society if you can't deal with numbers?
The limitation of consciousness, well, we're losing the best half of being alive.
What's locked behind that door?